Good evening and welcome to Election 2020 update for today. I'm your host, Romel Roopnarine, and joining me in the studio of MTV 65 is no other than Miss Priya Manickchand. Good evening, my dear.
Well, thank you very much, Romel, for having me.
Now, today we had quite a number of significant developments, wide-ranging, and specifically some major ones as it relates to where we are right now in terms of the recount of the votes for Region 4. Now, I want to start off from there because this would have been major. From since March 2 today, we had officially one of the parties, the political parties in the APNU AFC coalition, coming out now publicly and demanding a recount. And that is the Justice for All Party with C.N. Sharma and Savitri Singh.
Right. So if you remember, Romel, thank you. Good night, everybody. This is the 17th day, on the 19th of March, after our election. Just by way of a fact, fun fact, in 2001, our general and national elections were actually held on the 19th of March. And we didn't have to wait 17 days for results. And we definitely were far more in a certain place at that time, 17 days later. But yes, if you recall, the AP and UAFC constantly boast of having a coalition of political parties, and they're the Benab, they're the Rainbow, and they're this coalition of unity. Well, one of those parties today broke with that, broke from the Benab, one of the five political parties, in fact, one of the major ones, I think, because, you know, Mr. Sharma has a voice, and they actually broke from the APNU, part of the coalition, and demanded an immediate recount of the ballots in a transparent and fair manner. And I want to commend C.N. Sharma, Chandran Narayan Sharma, and Savitri Sharma, and their members and supporters for that very late but commendable position taken to demand a recount of the votes. Listen, let's just back up a little bit, Romel. Where are we? We had an election on March 2nd. On March 2nd, Guyanese went into different polling places in a really nice turnout. In fact, I was so excited about that. I thought, finally, we're having really nice turnouts, percentage turnouts. People are interested in what's happening in their country. You know, when you see apathy, not only in Ghana, but across the world, it really means people are despondent and tired of politicians. So I was very pleased to see the level of turnout we saw. And people went into those polling booths having listened to a campaign almost for a year, because more than a year, because the APNU AFC had been voted out of government through a no confidence motion, and they were supposed to hold an election in 3 months. That didn't happen. So the people of Ghana have known for at least a year that they were going to have an election, they'd have to pick their leaders. And they were paying keen attention to all of us, what we were saying, what promises we were making, what kind of track record we had in delivering promises we had already made. And they went into those polling places, perhaps the most informed that they'd ever been in any other election in this country, and they made choices. They chose people they wanted to govern them. And the record of how people voted that day is on a document called the Statement of Poll. That's the only evidence, except for the ballot paper, that exists about what people wanted, what was their intent, what was their will. That's the only record existing. And that is the document that should be used to count up how many people voted for the PPP, how many voted for APNU, and so on. And in nine regions, region 1, 2, 3, 4, region 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, that document was used. And results were declared. So by Wednesday, Thursday, we had the election on Monday. By Thursday, every region had declared their results. The only region that remained outstanding was Region 4. Region 4 began using the statements of poll and did 421 places using that record of how people voted and their 879 boxes. What became very apparent was that the APNU was not doing as well as they were telling people they wanted to do or that they needed to do to win the elections. And all of a sudden, the statements, the poll got tossed aside, and the returning officer and his staff started using a spreadsheet and just calling numbers. Numbers that do not reflect how people voted, numbers that do not reflect what people want, numbers that put more people inside the polling place than the list allows. Just recklessly calling numbers to give the APNU an increased thing. Objections were made to that by the PPP and every single other party, not just the PPPC. The observers were all present after that commotion. In fact, that was done for 21 polling places. Out of the 21 polling places, 17 had heavily inflated numbers for the APNU and reduced numbers for the PPP. After that, objections were made to that. They went back to the statements of poll for about four boxes. We had a whole set of intervening events. Somebody got sick, somebody felt tired, who can't speak because they're so sleepy. A lot of ridiculous excuses. Now in retrospect, it was all part of the plan. And then on Thursday morning, Mr. Mingo came, attempted to declare results in the room. He was roundly objected and rejected by every political party in the room. And then what has now become famous, on the 5th of March, he stood on a balcony, nobody could hear what he said, and declared results that give the APNU more votes than they got and do not reflect how people voted in the polling place. That was subsequently challenged. It was overturned. The Chief Justice overturned it, vitiated that, made it null and void, and she said we must go back to the court. We must go back to the process and use the statements of poll because this is the only record. And in her words, it is a conclusive record of how people voted, except we go back to the ballots. And she specifically was very clear about how it should be used and so on. Mr. Mingo went back, attempted again not to use it the way it was supposed to be used. We went back to court with a contempt motion. In that process, the Chief Justice said very clearly, and this, and by this time, Mingo, Claudette Singh, all of them were in the courtroom, and she was a little impatient with you know, big adult people coming here. Well, this, my judgment was very clear. But of course, now we know that it was all a grand plan. But I remember her specifically saying that you have to let the political parties see the statement of poll.
Yes.
You have to let the observers see the statement of poll. You have to let the people in the room who are entitled to be there see this statement. Whether you put it on a screen or you project it onto the wall or you hold it up, you have to let them see it. So much so that she touched her eye and she said, you know, you have to let them see it. And then she said, oh, I shouldn't be touching my eye with corona around. Mr. Mingo went back on that fateful Friday the 13th, put excerpts of some statement of poll onto the wall that nobody could see, but when they could see it, there were clear marks on it, and proceeded to call numbers that heavily inflated the APNU score and at the same time reduced the PPP score. Sometimes the APNU score was increased by 200%. The PPP score was reduced by 50%, 75%. Giving the APNU more votes than the people of Guyana, that the people of Region 4 wanted them to have. And proceeded to make a declaration on those results. Subsequent to that, the places, very many organizations and partners of Guyana and so on started making very strongly worded statements about how very vulgar that process was. And people were very clear, any president sworn in on those results that were arrived at from that process would not be legitimate and would not be treated as being legitimate. On Saturday, that happened Friday. On Saturday, President Granger called Mia Mottley, Prime Minister of Barbados, who's also the chair of CARICOM, and he said that I don't feel comfortable, according to the statements that came out, with being sworn in on results that are not transparent. His words, he used the words that these results, he wouldn't feel comfortable because they're not transparent enough. Those results have never changed. So if he ever gets sworn in on those results, he himself deemed them to be not transparent. And Ms. Motley, capable woman, put together a team from all across the Caribbean, I think from Grenada, from Dominica, Trinidad, Barbados. And by evening, those people were on the ground. The five-member team were actually on the ground in Guyana and expecting to start a recount. What it is Mr. Granger asked for was a recount. The PPP said, although the time had been passed for recount in region, in the other nine regions, we said no problem. You could have a recount there too. And the people were here for recount, and from then to now it's been a circus. The circus has continued, and it is now absolutely disgraceful and vulgar where the APNUAFC has placed this country. And what GCOM has done to us as a nation, it's absolutely unacceptable. So what happened after that is the people were here, they're willing to go, and then GCOM started making a whole set of excuses. They have to see an aid memoir. They have to get the agreement between the president and the opposition leader and the CARICOM heads. They have to see it in writing. Then when they saw it in writing, they said spray the convention center for coronavirus. Well, it started out as Corona, yeah. Which was odd because nobody had occupied that building for a good month and a half. So we haven't had Corona in the country. But anyway, then it turned out it wasn't Corona they were spraying for, because of course you can't spray fumigate for Corona. It was ants that they were trying to spray for. Then they shut off the lights. Then they put us out of the building. Eventually, the APNU, an APNU candidate went to the court and said that the process that her presidential candidate, David Granger, initiated and agreed to and agreed upon should not be done. That is, the recount should not be done because it was not whatever it is she said. But I just want to point out, an APNU candidate went to the court to say that her presidential candidate, the process he asked for, the process he agreed to, that it was null and void and should not be granted, and it should not be done, and an injunction was actually granted stopping the recount and instructing Mr. Mingo, the returning officer for Region 4, to act on the results declared that their own presidential candidate has said is not transparent. The results that are results that are not transparent. So it's really become a hot mess. In all of this, for me, we've seen a coalition of parties, the APNU-AFC, people who can't be trusted. Can't be trusted with your vote, can't be trusted with your right to pick a government. And that, for me, is really saddening. It's very, very sad. But that's where we are right now.
Well, from that point, we had two other major developments today. We probably start with what happened at Gifland today, because people are still watching as we speak right now. Random citizens, along with the political reps of all the political opposition parties, they're out there. They have been keeping watch. But today, and we saw that the Private Sector Commission and a few other agencies had come out also in condemnation for what they saw as the police force being highly political in this event, and they were clearly biased. And we've also seen a former police commissioner pleading with the force not to throw their loyalty to the dogs based on what he has observed. Today now, the proprietor of Gifland Mall reported in a public statement that someone from the Guyana Police Force, and their images of that individual, he's from Special Branch, we're told, came into the building there and told them that the cameras, all the cameras that have been trained there since this business was established to the north, which would capture the convention center and the road leading out, along with, by chance, the ballot boxes where they are stored, that all those cameras pointing there are now illegal, and requested that for him to turn away those cameras from the site.
So in that process, I just briefed so that we could, you know, get on with the rest of the program, just in case there's someone in the world, although I doubt it, who didn't know all that happened before. So in that process, just know that it was not GCOM alone, nor the APNU alone. Some members of the police force, the Guyana Police Force, not all. So I want to be very clear, not all. There are people who are very uncomfortable with what they, I see it in their faces and I see it in the body language. They do not want to follow these unlawful instructions. But there are some members of the force who are helping to carry out, actively carry out this kind of the attempt to rig this election. And it's very clear. So throughout that period that I spoke about, from the 2nd to the 5th, and then the 13th, you saw police being used to come in and tell us there is a bomb threat in the building. That building was never searched and the building never blew up, so I don't know which bomb that was. That brought in people with guns, policemen with guns, vested with gun, bulletproof vests, to evict political party candidates from Ashman Building. The police is being used, the riot squad is being used to evict candidates last night, the night before, to evict candidates from the convention center. Now remember I said the statement, the poll holds the record of how people voted, but the other record is actually the ballot paper, where you can go in and see where someone marked their X, and those ballot papers are mostly all stored at the convention center. They went there because we were preparing to start the recount there. Those ballot boxes are there. So people of Guyana, political parties, and just regular people, Romel, it's really beautiful to watch ordinary young people who are not related to political parties, who have nothing to do with politics, are turning up and camping out and scrolling and doing their homework, their research there and so on, just to be able to keep an eye on the ballots, because we do not trust GCOM. We do not trust the government presently, although there is none. We do not trust the police force to look after those ballots. And that's not the PPP Civic alone or the other political parties. It is ordinary Guyanese doing that, civil society organizations, different people doing that. So right there, the police was used to riot police, to evict us. We were not rioting. We were invited there to count ballots, and we were waiting to be able to do that. The police there attempted to evict Roopnarine, a commissioner of the Guyana Elections Commission. This is a statutory office, all of the Constitution gives him his power. And they ended up throwing him on the ground. He has a shoulder injury now. So the police is being used in all of this. And the report from the Giffland group of companies today, where they said that the police had come to say that they should not have their cameras where they always were, because they will accidentally or inadvertently capture what's happening at the convention center. It's really very worrying. It is very, very worrying. It makes me wonder what it is. The people who can and who have shown us over the last couple of days that they have no scruples in trying to rig this election, what is it you want to do with those boxes?
Yes.
Very, very worrying. I want to warn, caution, bring to the attention of the professional men and women in the force, one, that you do not have to follow unlawful instructions. You know that, you learned it, you don't have to follow it. And secondly, this is a different country. This country is not going to tolerate the young people, the older people, the middle-aged people in this country and their friends around the world. They're not going to tolerate anymore the kind of behavior that might have happened when Mr. Granger and his friends were in their 20s and 30s. That's not going to be tolerated anymore. Do not get caught doing things, because I tell you what, you may be a police officer attempting to execute your duty. Nobody's going to stand with you when you're in trouble. You will be left alone. Yes. And so the police officers who are being asked to do this, tell your boss, let you come and do it. Tell your boss to come and move people. Tell your boss to go and warn Giffland. Don't let him use you, because you will be the person named in those proceedings. You will be the person behind bars. That is how it works. Nobody's going to stand in your shoe for that. So I am bringing that forcefully to the attention of the men and women who chose to make policing and securing and serving this nation a career. It is a noble, honorable career. You should not let anyone who has narrow political interests use you for that. While they're using you for that, and you will be locked away somewhere, their children are studying in Ivy League universities across the world, on your taxpayer dollar, by the way.
Now, following that, all of this, what happened today with the Ramjetan statement and the what happened at Giffland, it coincided with, we've seen a surge now right across the country and even internationally. Persons are becoming uneasy and they're saying it is time to swear in Irfan. Irfan must be sworn in as early as possible as president of the country. We have seen even more desperation now from the APNU AFC camp. More so, Ramjetan came to light today and he said clearly that he's integrally involved in this process. Mm-hmm. He's not behind any cloud. And I want to just quote, he was quoted in, there must be a presumption of regularity of what GCOM does. We may suspect, have our concerns, be going crazy with what we believe might have gone wrong, but we have to believe until that presumption is rebutted. It is rebutted after an election ends and it's completed by a swearing in of a president and then by a court with jurisdiction to hear witnesses, open and recount boxes.
Yeah, please stop. This man is nauseating. Let me tell you, Kemraj Ramjetan is the biggest disappointment I've come across. And this is, I say this from a personal perspective. I know this gentleman. I saw him fight for people and their rights, and he's now placed himself in a position just because of greed and want for power and office and money where people have to fight him for their rights. And that is a sickening, disgusting, disgraceful position for him to be in. This is someone who stood up and fought for people to get their rights and taught many of us who were looking on or working with him that this was our duty. And it's now become our duty to fight Kemraj Ramjetan for what is rightfully ours as human beings and as people who enjoy rights conferred upon us by the constitution of this country. And I say shame on him. He has children, he has grandchildren. And look at what he's doing to the people in this country. Up to today's date, I kid you not, Romel, up to today when he put out this crappy statement, I said to myself, he can't be with this. I mean, I understand these party dynamics. You don't want to come out against your party. But he's not forcefully in the forefront of this. This here makes me say to him, he should bag his face. He should retire permanently from public life because he can serve no person. No person he can serve with this kind of attitude and behavior and this thinking. This ideology. What he's asking you to believe here is that we must presume that GCOM, there is a presumption.
That's all of, the evidence we saw.
Of regularity. But let's talk about that. He's a lawyer and he's no fool. But Roxanne George, Chief Justice, in the matter, was implored by Boston, the lawyer for GCOM, the APNU, whoever you want to say he was a lawyer for. She was implored to say the same thing, that you have to presume GCOM is acting with regularity. You have to presume that what they're doing is regular. Romel, what GCOM is doing is standing up and saying the APNU, this polling station had 300 people listed to vote. The APNU got 400 votes. How on earth could any sensible person presume that there's regularity in that? The person is reading from nothing. The record that they're using, that they're supposed to use, which is the statement of poll or the ballot, that is not being used. He's just calling numbers to be able to give one party an advantage over the other. That can nowhere in the world, with right-minding people, invite one to assume that things are regular. And she specifically ruled that you could not, so that matter came up, it was addressed, that there was no presumption of regularity if he wasn't going to use the documents that the law says he absolutely must use. So Kemraj Ramjetan asking us to presume this to be regular is as foolish as someone saying I'm standing at the top of my car and staring with my legs, and the police officer, the traffic officer, must not stop me because just because I'm sitting on this vehicle, you must presume me to be regular. You must presume that what I'm doing is regular. It is as stupid as saying someone could stand up and allocate to somebody else. This is just ridiculous. Let me not even try with further examples. It cannot be presumed to be regular if he wasn't doing substantially what he had to do in law, which is to use those documents in the presence of the people who were supposed to be present. And so for him to say, what he's essentially telling you is this: you gotta think the man, what you doing, you gotta say what you doing is right. And if you're happy with it, as much as you might be screaming about it, you must go to court afterwards. So the next election we have in 2025, after Irfan is sworn in here and he holds one, the next election in 2025, a returning officer could just stand there and call names for numbers for a political party. Everybody in the world knows that those numbers are not accurate. Everybody in the world knows they cannot be accurate because they exceed the number of people who should have been voting. But we must presume that it is correct, and we must go to court only after. That is such a stupid argument. It is such a foolish argument that Kemraj Ramjetan should retire from public life forever. And this is so disappointing. So disappointing that he's turned into this greedy, power-hungry person. So disappointing. If you want us to presume that this is right and challenge it only in court, we could never, ever, ever have a fair election in this country again.
That is true.
Ever. So, and this, it's just such a stupid argument. We should have presumed when he was running for AFC presidential candidate or whatever, leader or whatever. We should presume that Moses Nagamutu will get more votes and just he should challenge it later on. We should presume that Irfan Ali will win the election and he could challenge it later on. What did the Commonwealth people say? This is the latest statement. Everybody has spoken, but let's talk about the latest statement from the Commonwealth Observer Group. The Commonwealth is made up of 54 nations in this world. So 54 countries are speaking when they speak. And what did they say? They said that in many instances, while they were observing this entire process, in many instances, the APNU was given more votes than it was given when the first declaration was made. So when they first did this on the 5th, in these cases, the APNU was given more. They said in many cases, the APNU were given more votes so that when you calculated how much the APNU got, and you did a cumulative number, a sum, you add them up, more people existed in these numbers that they were calling than were on the list to vote. They said that repeated objections were made and nothing was done about it. They said that none of the bosses at GCOM came in to say, you shouldn't be doing this, it is wrong, or try to resolve the issue. They said that nobody could observe or see the thing the Chief Justice said needed to happen, the statements of poll. You want us to presume that regularity happened here just so that you could be sworn in Prime Minister. Like I said, Kemraj Ramjetan should be a name that goes down in the history of this country as synonymous with disgraceful, and he should retire from public office. That is the best thing he can do for himself right now.
Plus, he's still to catch that fourth Russian spy.
Yeah, you know, those kinds of things. You chase people down, try to arrest them, get their passport, or on some idiotic thing him and Kathy Hughes have going with Russian spies. We vote with a pencil and a piece of paper. And in the polling place, we hold up the piece of paper and we check to see with our naked eye where somebody marked with their pencil on that paper their X. And that's how we count it. We have no computer system that could allow for hacking either in the place of poll or in the counting of the poll. So that kind of, I mean, what goes into your head to say stupid things like that? At some stage, he has to have some self-pride. And apparently he has none. And I don't believe people with none can serve effectively in public office with dignity, and so I think he should step aside.
Now, we spoke about one of the coalition partners. Now, we also saw today that the ACTA, the African Cultural Development Association, and traditionally they have been sympathetic to the PNC, APNU, AFC. Today we saw them also issue a statement for a recount of votes.
Right, and you know, that's why, Romel, so I want to congratulate and commend also ACTA for saying that the votes should be recounted. The reality is this: the whole world has seen this on live TV. people had roll cameras were on, people were Facebook streaming live. The media was outside, they were carrying this live. All the ambassadors from the main countries, our main partners, well, I don't want to say main partners, from some of our important partners, all our partners are important, some of the bigger countries were there. All the observers from various groups were there. So this happened in front of the world, literally, through a camera, as well as figuratively, through the representatives of various countries. And people can no longer dispute what happened. It is very clear that the number of votes that were allocated to the AP and UAFC, one particular party who was competing, do not reflect the will of the people. And so all the countries and representatives and bodies have been saying that if anyone is sworn in on the basis of that declaration and those results that went through that very, very opaque, dishonest, fraudulent process, those persons, that would form an illegitimate government. They have gone further. We're not talking anymore about who's at fault, because I see James Bond and somebody else today trying to make the distinction between APNU and GCOM. Two things about that. One, I don't know that GCOM woke up one morning and decided we're going to rig this election and give it to APNU.
And how well the signature ended up on one.
Precisely. So it's not GCOM doing this by themselves, for themselves, with themselves. This is GCOM acting in collusion with the APNU and members and or members thereof, as well as members of the Ghana Police Force, to carry out a massive rig on national TV. So we have that as one issue. But people have gone past that conversation. If you listen to Mike Pompeo from the United States, the Secretary of State for the United States of America, he didn't talk about who's at fault, because we don't care anymore who's at fault. We'll fix that later on as we go forward, in terms of, with a view to making sure it doesn't happen again. But at this stage, what he said is anyone who benefits from these fraudulent results will not be deemed legitimate and will suffer serious consequences. So we've gone past whose fault it is, and we're saying whoever fault it is, whoever benefits from it. Now let me ask you something. If you keep thiefing something and bringing it to me, and the whole world is saying Priya Romel is thiefing and bringing this phone to you, and I still take this phone, I am as guilty as the person who took it, even if I didn't instruct him to take it. Because it is now brought to my attention. The whole world is telling you. And they're telling you, I saw Romel, we filmed him on camera, our ambassador saw him thiefing it, and he still bring it to you. I'm not supposed to take it, because it is now brought to my attention. Assuming I didn't know, it is now brought to my attention that Romel is a thief and he's given me stolen goods. And so they have gone past the conversation about whose fault it is. And they're saying whoever benefits from it, whoever accepts that stolen goods, those fraudulent results, will get into serious trouble. So for me, the whole ACDA initially seemed resistant to the idea of a recount. But having been presented with all the evidence, perhaps they took a time, because sometimes organizations are like that. They take a while to get together and assimilate everything. Today, I was very pleased to see them come out and say that the APN, there must be a recount of the ballot. That's the only way we can have credible results. And to say that that must be done speedily and so on. They have some other things about shared governance and so on. But the important thing is that that organization, like the Justice for All Party, today called for an immediate recount. I just saw an article just before I came here from one of our Caribbean writers saying there'd better be a recount. In fact, he ended it by saying, Ron Sanders, he ended it by saying that by the time he's finished writing, or by the time the article is published, we may well have had a process begun for a recount. Oh, Mr. Sanders, you so don't know the APN UAFC. Nothing has begun, and they're still fighting to get a court to say that it should not happen. And he was being very clear that there would be no recourse for places like the OAS and the Commonwealth and CARICOM. There would be no choice left but for those organizations who we need, we're a part of them, to say that we're illegitimate and to ban us, really, and suspend us from membership with them.
just to show you also the seriousness that you mentioned, but the irony at play here, where you have these few officials that are pushing this illegal line and what they're doing from the APNU EFC, saying that we don't want the foreigners here, we don't want them, we don't need them, we can do without them. And the minister, or well, the former minister of finance, I don't know how he's still acting, but today we saw in the media that they're asking the, I think it's the World Bank, for $5 million to help them fight the COVID-19.
Right, and so first of all, we don't have any ministers. We do not have any ministers, not because I said so, because the law says so. We don't have any ministers in the government. We have a caretaker president that remains president, although in a caretaker capacity, until a new president is sworn in. So I'm not sure who asked the World Bank for money, because there's nobody in place to ask them for money, except it's our technical people. People walking around the place with bodyguards and in the vehicles and so on should not be happening, because they have no entitlement to that. They are no longer ministers. On the midnight of March 1st, they should not have been. They're no longer ministers. The issue that raises about us being independent, we are independent, we are sovereign, but we live in a global world. This is no longer, you see how this works. If we want a very, very, very real and horrific example, it's COVID. So what we have is, what did I just say? The virus.
Yes.
That's what I'm talking about. So what we have is something that started in China, is now in Guyana, and in very, very many countries in the world. And it is deadly, and it's affecting a large part of the global population. Now, we can't possibly sit down in those circumstances and believe that Guyana is an island by herself, and we can govern by ourselves, and we can live by ourselves without any kind of friends and allies across the world. It has never happened. It will never happen. And so the abuse down that we can do this alone and we don't need anybody, as you highlighted, became very ironic when we ran at the first sign of trouble to ask our international partners, who right now don't think we have a government and have said to us that if we swear these people in, that's the Granger administration, if we swear them in, then we won't have a legitimate government, we won't have any legitimacy, then we go to ask them for money at a time when we so badly need help, that they're saying we so badly need help. So to me, and you know, we have observers for a reason, so let's make the distinction. People came here, nobody wanted to count the ballots, nobody wanted to hold up ballots, nobody wanted to, what they were doing was observing. They observed, as they have done in many, many other, in 2015, these same people observed. The PPP had problems in 2015 with what happened, and I hope now it's become clear to everybody that what we were complaining about happened at GCOM, probably very likely happened at GCOM. And so we may not have lost those elections. Unfortunately, the petition is still to be heard that we challenged. The petition to challenge those elections, and the result, we have another one upon us, and that has not been heard as yet. Quite an indictment. But I'm saying that the same observer groups and ABC countries and so on that declared APNU AFC winners in 2015, whom they celebrated, whose declarations they relied upon to make themselves legitimate. The same set of people are here now, they have not changed, and they're saying what happened here was wholly fraudulent and a rigged process. Unfortunately, the only people defending them, which is for me very telling, the only people defending GCOM, the only people who saying no, GCOM's process is not rigged, nothing is wrong with what they did, is the APNU AFC. So you have to conclude that there's a very strong collusion between them. In case anybody was in doubt, I never was. So yes, it's unfortunate that our partners and friends are being abused in that manner, but I don't think it will matter to them, because you see, Romel is much, much bigger than Guyana. It's not about what Granger and his cohorts want to do to the people of Guyana and the PPPC and the other political parties. If you create a dictatorial regime and country in Guyana, you make the rest of the world unstable. So interconnected we are.
That's right.
So interconnected we are. The same thing that could bring the virus, the COVID virus from China to Trinidad, to Guyana, to Jamaica, to Cuba, to Canada, to Switzerland, to Spain, to Italy, all over the world. We're so interconnected that people in the world cannot afford to have an unstable dictatorial administration in Guyana, because it makes them all unsafe. When we have mad people acting here in such a high capacity, it makes everybody unsafe in the world. And so it's not going to be tolerated. It won't be allowed. If you want to call that interference, go ahead. But it's not. All the observers did, nobody interfered so far. All the observers did was what they're supposed to do. According to law, they came, they observed, and they gave a report. The report may not be liked by the people who are trying to rig an election, but they haven't broken the law.
Now, with all of that in mind, tomorrow is a very big day, obviously, as we move further and further into this. I should say, some people say it's, they refer to it as a nightmare, but what do we expect? That the PPP will be... the PPP lawyers, they
so what happened, as you recall, after the CARICOM was called by David Granger and asked to engage in a process where they would supervise a recount, not do the recount, they're not holding any ballots, just coming to make sure that the people who are doing the recount, because we don't trust GCOM. The world does not trust GCOM. So the people who are coming to do the recount, that they will know that their outside eyes looking at them and hopefully do it in the right manner. So Granger asked for that. Jagdeo agreed to that. Everybody breathed a sigh of relief. The whole country took exhaled a little bit, felt like finally we were going to have some sanity prevailing here. And then Granger's candidate goes and gets lawyers associated with Granger and gets an injunction to stop him from doing what he said he wanted to do. That's how ridiculous it is. The PNC took the PNC to court to stop what the PNC said the PNC was going to do. That's where we are. And it's not the PNC alone. It used to be the PNC. It is now APNU-AFC. So the APNU-AFC has taken the APNU-AFC to court to stop what the presidential candidate of the APNU-AFC agreed to do, not only with Barajak, the leader of the opposition, but with the Caribbean community. That is how ridiculous we have gotten. That was an ex parte application. By ex parte, I mean we were not included in it. We were not present before the court, not only the PPPC, but any other political party that was affected adversely. They were not present before the court. And so tomorrow, the PPPC, as well as other political parties that contested the election, the new parties, are going to be applying to join into the matter. I expect that that is going to be granted, because every matter there that was dealt with touched and concerned those persons applying tomorrow in a very, very real way. And then they also have their own applications to make. So I'm not sure what's going to happen with that. It is before a judge for 9 o'clock in the morning.
Okay. Now, so we basically have a clear understanding as to what will happen or what we expect to happen tomorrow. So all eyes will be...
We'll be applying for... to get into the matter so that we could be heard, and then for those injunctions to be discharged.
Yes.
So what are the injunctions? One of them stops the recount from happening, that they're the presidential candidates for both, well, for the APNU and the general secretary of the PPP agreed to. And one of them forces Mr. Mingo and Mr. Lowenfield to use Mr. Mingo's perverse results that Granger said are not transparent. So we're trying to get those out of the way so that we could actually proceed with some kind of sane forward movement, which would be to have a recount of all 10 regions and then to declare thereafter.
Okay. So moving on from the elections, but it's kind of tied in because it's having an effect right now in society. A lot of persons are a bit worried, and it's related. This, in our efforts to tackle the coronavirus, COVID-19, we have seen just recently an order, presidential order, granting, and we see ministers again. You just mentioned that the law states very clearly that we don't have any ministers functioning. But we see even more so, persons are a bit worried that the order gives these officials wide-ranging powers. Some as they could go in and they could burn properties, destroy properties, and so forth. And there have been a lot of political conspiracy theories people are advancing, right? More so concerns that maybe those containers that are housing the ballot boxes might be the focus. And it might seem a bit extreme, but bearing in mind what we have seen these past several days, nothing we could afford to take for granted.
Right, so let me see. COVID-19 is a worldwide pandemic. That's the meaning of pandemic. Problem in the whole world that has hit us in Guyana. Guyana was just deemed by the IMF to be wholly unprepared for this. In fact, we're flagged in red because we're so unprepared for this virus. And if it hits us, it is very serious. And I ask every single person who is watching us tonight to make sure you do all that you have to do. Don't congregate in groups. Wash your hands. Stay home as much as you can. Don't be liming. Don't be partying. Don't be gathering up at gaffing and so on unnecessarily. It is important that we do what we have to do. And make sure you wash your hands with soap. I heard salt soap is really good. Wash it really well so that you could get rid of germs as often as possible. So we have to take COVID seriously. Now, the reason, and this really brings home to us how important it is in the democratic process, not only to hold an election, but to have an early declaration of results. Look at what we have. We have a crisis on our hands health-wise that international places who have enormous experience with this have already said, Guyana, you're wholly unprepared. You're going to be in a lot of trouble if this thing hits you hits you more than it has hit us right now. But we have a government that nobody trusts. Well, we don't have a government, that's the first thing. So we don't have ministers of the government. We don't have a minister of health. We don't have a minister of public security. And all the ministers who were deemed to have been given orders under this, powers under this order. We don't have ministers in the government. We have a president who himself should not be exposed to this virus, frankly, and who cannot technically do the things that he needs to do. So we don't have a government in place to deal with something that is a national and international crisis. The people who are there that are purporting to act on our behalf are wholly untrusted. Nobody trusts Valda Lawrence. Nobody trusts Kemra Dramjitan. Nobody trusts Felix. Nobody trusts Moses Nagamutu. These are the people who sat at a press conference. In something where we need this whole population, PPP people, APNU people, Georgetown people, Morbis people, Region 3 people, Letem people, we need everybody to listen to the authorities who are giving information, who are giving advice, who are telling us where we can get services. We need people to listen to them, believe them, and trust in them. And nobody trusts the people who are there right now. Not because they're from a political party, but because they just spent two weeks lying to this nation, 2 weeks sitting in an office that they have no entitlement to. So this order that has come out is very worrying because it speaks of powers, it gives powers to purported ministers who, like I said, don't exist, and to the police force. Police force never should have powers in a health crisis. It gives powers to people to do some very draconian things, like burn premises. Now, I'm no doctor, but I've read enormously on this because I want to protect myself and those around me, and the virus does not even last long enough in premises to require the premises to be burnt. There are certain diseases that you recommend burning the place down so that you can get rid of it. COVID is not one of those. There's no reason to put that order in. And because these are the same set of people who stood on a platform and stole an election in front of the world, nobody trusts that that was just an an accident. People believe it was put there either to intimidate party members that are not political opponents, or to use it against political opponents, or to destroy the ballot boxes. And you know, added to that, the man this morning, the policeman this morning, telling the Giffland man
to move the
move your cameras and so on. So the point I'm making, Romel, you said that, you know, it sounds far-fetched. It does not sound far-fetched to me. It does not sound far-fetched to people who are making, who are expressing that as a serious concern and worry, because they watch the same set of people either attempt themselves to steal this election or condone it. And so they don't trust the people that are in office there. We need to get on with a recount. Whoever wins the recount, form the government, and let's deal with this crisis that we have on our hands. Other than that, we are left in no man's land. The people of this country are left up. You're telling police officers they must go, if this is what you're saying in the order, and you genuinely meant that order. You're telling policemen and women who have families they want to go home to too, that they must go and capture a family or a man or a woman who has COVID, and God knows do what to him. Police officers are not medically trained people. They too would like to go home when the afternoon comes, and so you can't send them in harm's way. So that order is very suspect. I believe this is perfectly one of the types of events that call for bipartisan, calls for a multi-stakeholder approach involving every leader in this country. Right now we don't have a government. So who is even going to convene that meeting? And so that is why we really, really need to get on with this recount. Do it when we open those boxes. Whoever wins, wins. So if it is APNU and AFC, Cameron Tramtitan, if you know you win, let's open the boxes. And that will be a presumption of regularity. Whatever we find in the boxes, we could complain later on about whether somebody else mark off an X or something else. But that is how we could determine what really happened in those polling places. That is how we could give effect to the will of the people of this country. And then once we do that, we find out what's in the box, we quickly swear in a go, we get cracking on this issue of COVID, because it needs to be addressed, and it needs to be addressed seriously.
Now, We've come to the close of our time for this evening's program. But before we go, as always, I'm sure you would have been inundated with constantly messages with persons that are uneasy about what's happening, people complaining that you're having sleepless nights, and we've seen a lot of that manifest in itself, persons on their own. As we spoke about earlier, they're coming out, they're joining the efforts to watch over ballot boxes, or they, as soon as they notice something irregular, they are there with information, or they're asking questions. What message would you have for those persons?
Roman, I can't lie, this has been heartbreaking for me, particularly because I didn't think leaders in 2020 would take us down this path. I didn't ever think that we would have, this has been so mind-boggling. Every new day comes with a new ridiculous story that is almost unbelievable. I think somebody has to write a script. The authors and writers amongst us and the artists are going to shake themselves out of this shock hopefully soon and start writing about it. I am so heartbroken by the Roopnarines and Carl Greenidge and people who I hold up to such. These are people who have served this nation. These are people who said they believed in rights. These are people, Kemraj Ramjitan, these are people who are breaking my heart. I could not believe that they would do this. At the same time, and I can't believe that we're watching ballot boxes for 24 hours and that we are getting ushered out by the police forcefully from places that we have a right to be. And that policemen and women who were told join the force and serve and protect Guyana are now being used and exploited in this manner. All of that is really, really depressing. And then you have, on the other hand, young people turning up in numbers and old people turning up in numbers, cross-party, cross-ethnicity, cross-geographic region, coming to watch ballot boxes and coming to say, this is my vote it will be protected. And coming to say, this is not my vote in that box from Region 5. We're going to come and help you watch the Region 4 people's votes. And people leaving what they do, the Joe Sings and the C. Lyles and the C.N. Sharmas and Singh and Jerome Kahn, and saying openly that Melinda Janke and Marie Chomley and those people writing and saying, for all that I can speak, for all the voice I have, I will not stop until this stops. And that for me is the human spirit rising up from all this drudgery and all this horror that the APNU has brought onto us, rising up and resisting it and saying, we will not have it. The world is not going to take it, and Guyana is not going to take it, and we're going to rise up against this. And I promise you, my friends, we are going to see democracy prevail. Because in the world, good always overcomes evil. We're living in a different world. I know you could say, well, that good took a long time on the chatty, and I know that can be a depressing thought. But it's a different world. It's different people, and we are going to see democracy prevail. I promise you that. The PPP is going nowhere. We're going nowhere. We have leaders in Barajangdeo and Irfan Ali and others who are going to stand with us. We're going to stand with you. We're not leaving you. And we so appreciate your helping hand and your watchful eye throughout this period. I have been so inspired by the new parties who have so little resources, but who themselves are insistent that you will not steal this election. So pleased by religious people coming out, so pleased by people who ordinarily you might not see coming out in the middle of the night to watch a ballot box, so pleased by people lending their facilities and resources, and that for me takes away, in fact I think it's beautiful to watch, and it's something I wouldn't have given up, although it came after this horrible period that we've been made to go through. So stay hopeful. We're going nowhere. We're going to make sure democracy prevails in this country, you and us together.
Thank you very much, Priya. And before I close, let me just point out, just like Priya, we have in the People's Progressive Party Civic dynamic team of leaders. We have our General Secretary, Dr. Barajagdeo, and for me, President-elect Irfan Ali, who is working far and beyond what he should have been doing now, right? But unfortunately, we have seen what has been happening over the past few days. But your leaders are working for you. They're on the ball. And rest assured that, as Priya said, good will always triumph evil. I'm Romel Roopnarine. Thank you very much and good night.
When she offers you some, come and get it, big boy. When she offers you some. We ask 100 married men, tell me something your wife might do that you better notice.
He better notice if we lose weight.
Mm-hmm. They already said that.
Okay.
They already said that.
Okay.
Y'all, get another one. Get another. Help out a little bit.
Okay, he better notice if we get mad.
Better notice if we get mad. Number six.
Reiterate.
Four. Three. Welfare Family 234. Army Family 74. It's still anybody's game. You only need one. You're playing well. We'll be back. Don't go away.
I've never had Burger King nuggets before. It's a lot better than I expected.
And the best part is, they're 8 for only $1.
What? These are good. It's crispy and it's golden. When you like see an ad like that, you don't